Ballo iadíomh go léir agus fáilte ar nach chuig an chlórmísúil an túl rinach. Tá súil a gcoinn go raibh nollag mai i gach aine agus nach raibh an Anna Ró Deacair díobh. Níor stop scrógal ag obair le linn na siire agus tá seó lán againn le ceol, sport agus an nádúr. Ná déan de rud má tá éon scéal nó ócáid a heasaíon mh reintlin chuircléachar nó buúlaisteach chuig an stúdio i Gúlín. Anois, bhí cáil ar an daingin i gcónaí ó thaobh an cheolde. Ach le déanaí, tá níos mó baní cheol is cultóirí ó fud an domhan i fula ar an baile chun seintúin. Le linn na nollag tháinig na Deans baní cheol blues agus rock ón ngáilbh ar cuairt chuig McCarthy's an seo sa daingin. Leabhar íomhan í thuilamh an leo faoin EP nua atá a chur amach acu.
My name is Eva Ní Húlafón. Now I'm here in McCarthy's Bar and Venue in Good Street in Dingle. This bar has been in the McCarthy family since the early 1800s and still has retained its original charm. It's also attracted some of the top musicians such as Glenn Hansard from The Frames, Paddy Casey, Mundy and Damien Dempsey to name but a few. Now, last night, the Deans from Galway entertained a crowd here, and if you weren't here, you certainly missed out. Now, details of their upcoming tours are available on their Facebook page, The Deans. So we're going to leave you with a video from their latest EP, Subterranean Wanderer.
Subterranean wanderer.
Tá aon eolas breise faoina Deans ar fáil ar an leathanach Facebook atá acu. Ar an taonna lá is fiche tharla an Ghrianstad Gaeraigh in Ard na Mór Lispól. Ba é seo an chéad bhliain a dearg Criste Féile Lispól ó cáid ar an lá is gcéire sa bhliain. Bhí busanna ann chun dul chuig Ard na Mór chun an ócáid speisialta a eiscint agus an son bhí léacht é mlúiríní blasta faoi seandálaíocht na leithanaise. Bhí íomh ann chun caiinte le Colm Murphy ceandas na heagrathóirí agus chathaoirleach CLG Lispól.
Where we just finished a celebration of the winter solstice with thanks to Phil Lispól, but I'm here with Colm Murphy, chairman of the Lispól GAA, who came up with the concept of this celebration of the winter solstice. So can you tell us, firstly, where did the vision or the concept come from?
Well, I suppose the winter solstice, as we saw today, it was obviously it happens on the 21st of December. We all know about Newgrange. The idea, I suppose, came for us was somebody mentioned to me about the positive energy, magnetism, and the draw that there is here to the Dingle Peninsula. And I suppose to prove that fact to me, they pointed out a few interesting things that I suppose I should have been aware of, but I wasn't. One was, you know, the amount of people, creative people, that have taken up residence here in Dingle and in Corcuigrina. And the other thing then was the concentration of megalithic and archaeological sites that are here on the Dingle Peninsula. I'm told there's somewhere between 2,000 and 2,500 of them, and it's the highest concentration of archaeological sites in Western Europe. The standing stones above an Ard na Mór, where we were today, is just one of them. I suppose the significance of them, as was mentioned here today, is that it was a marker for probably the farmers of the time, yeah, that winter had come to an end. Well, I won't say winter had come to an end, but certainly the days were going to be getting longer from here on. And you know, I suppose it was time then, that it was time to be getting the potatoes, the seed potatoes ready or whatever, whatever they were growing at the time. My knowledge of the archaeological sites, you know, it's fairly basic, but it was quite, we were very, very, very fortunate today, Eva.
We got the sun
for the first time of asking, and it was great, you know.
This was obviously a great, you know, great turnout for your first time organising something like this. Where do you hope this will go? You know, what's your long term vision?
Well, obviously it would be lovely to celebrate this every year, but you know, there is so much to admire here in the Dingle Peninsula. You know, I was at a meeting recently with a planner in Kerry County Council, and we all know we're in a recession. But the one thing he did say to me, you know, that probably the only two things that are left, particularly here in Kerry, are agriculture and tourism. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, we're here in the Dingle Peninsula, we have absolutely fantastic scenery, and we have great farmers. So where do we go from here? My vision would be that we would take advantage, I suppose, of what nature has provided for us. Like I said, we have the scenery, and we have the good food. You know, we have Blasket Island lamb, we have Murphy's ice cream, we have cheese made below in Castle Gregory by Maya. We now have our own brewery.
We do indeed.
And so, you know, if we could market all those things and attract more people into the peninsula, whether it is for a day, a week, or a month, then, you know, football clubs like ours might be able to hold on to the players that we're losing at the moment. So that would be my vision of it. I'd like to see more people come in and let them appreciate, let them taste, and let them see what we have to offer.
Very good. Well, for the first time, it was a very, very successful event, and congratulations with that, Colm.
Thank you, Eva. You know, we were very, very, very lucky, particularly, you know, the way the weather has been all summer, and with the last couple of days, even yesterday, my God, you know, if today came like yesterday, it would have been a pure disaster. But, you know, somebody is smiling on us, and maybe that's an omen for the future.
Very good. Well, best of luck with the future events. I'm sure there'll be many more coming up.
Thanks, Eva.
Okay, thanks, Colm, for taking time out to talk.
Bhí pobal scoil carcaríne ag céiliúr an tachtan seo tar éis cairní húil a bhain a thuairt a bhaile. Sé seo an cathrú uair a bhí an cairn tar éis tacht chuig mean scoil na daingin, ach an chéad uair don pobal scoil nua. Bhuaigh siad an clé ag gine Naomh Brown Dáin ag go Lárne, haon de puinte go dtí cúil is trí phointe. Chuig Liam O'Higgín ag caint leis an bainisteoir an éirinn John Flannery agus Reintas na himreoirí.
It's been a long, long time since I've seen you around. It's been a long, long time since I've been found. Oh, and just for the record, I think I'm still high. This world is absurd, but I'll get by. So where's the love?
I'm joined here by John Flannery, manager of the Pobl Scoil Carcaigrina, victorious in the Sullivan Cup final last Friday. Congratulations, John.
Thanks, Ian. Thank you very much.
A great success?
Great success, yeah. First time since 96, 97, I think, which was a 16-year gap, which is a huge achievement, really. First time for the Pobl Scoil. And they won it twice that time, back in 95 and 97. I think you might have been there yourself on those teams. And then you're going back to 1936, I think, to, let's say, Paddy Bowen's time and a few of these. So huge, huge gap and a great achievement overall. We're delighted.
Very good. How important has been the appointment of Vincent Flannery, full-time coach of the school team?
Very important, really. You know, I suppose it's part of our job. We take it. It is voluntary, but we are teachers and we're working with the lads on a daily basis. In terms of Vinny, he's no real affiliation with the school. He's just doing it because he loves doing it. I suppose when I was brought in, when I started off first, Ciarán Moran asked me to help him and to come on board, and I had no problem, and it was great working with Ciarán for a few years, but Ciarán had a lot of stuff on. His baby Katie came along, and then I left myself and Morris, who were two effectively young guys, so I felt anyway that we needed an older kind of head on board, and it was great to have somebody who wasn't dealing with the lads every day. It was somebody a bit different and who they weren't seeing, we say, in and out of classes all day. And going on through the years, Vinny's been training for about 30 years, I suppose, and everybody who's trained under him, they still have great time for him. He still has a great relationship. And it's what he does, you see, like, he's above training the lads now. He's in the middle of them. He's taking part of the training, even though he's getting a bit old now, I suppose, and he's a few injuries and stuff, but that's all part of it, and the lads love him, and he brings a great spirit and bond to the whole thing.
He bridged a 75-year gap last year by reaching the Munster College's final. Mm. A historic day, but rather like Dingle Bay Rovers last Sunday, the gods just weren't with Dingle that day.
No, a historic day getting there, but not one to really remember, I suppose, the way things went. Within the first minute, the ball was thrown in, and Padraig Shea went in for a challenge. And as luck should have it, he connected with the man as well as the ball, and he unfortunately got a red card. After that, then we settled the ship a small bit, and unfortunately, after I think it was 20 minutes, Colm Galvin got injured as well. It was a recurrence of his cruciate injury. So we were really up against it then, two of your leaders and best players gone, two fellas who were on the Kerry Minor panel at the time. So, in fairness, then we went in at half-time and the lads made an agreement that they'd try and give it their all for the boys who were after getting injured, and we did it. We came back, we were down 4 points or so at half-time, wouldn't be sure, but we came back and we were a pint up. But unfortunately, we just ran out of steam, you know. There was fellas midfield, Ryan Begley, put on a great performance that day, and they just didn't have the legs. They were after putting in so much extra work for the guys who had, for the man down and for lads getting injured. And in the end, we just fell a bit short, but that's what happens, you know.
You have massive turnover of players from that team. You mentioned Ryan Begley, Ryan has left, Colm Galvin has gone, possibly one or two more, but largely it seems you have pretty much the same team as lined out in Lewis Road that day. Does that create its own pressure? The fact that you're now kingpins of Kerry football, you're no longer dark horses.
No longer, no. I suppose we came in under the radar a little bit last year, and all the players you did mention gone were very influential. Ryan, Colm Galvin, Adrian Rael, a few of the older heads. You see, the school we have, you've small numbers, you're dealing with about 200 or 220 lads in comparison with the Sems and the Greens, the Crease Threes are 600-700. So you're going to have that turnover.
You mentioned the Sem and their pick, and you mentioned Intermediate School Club and quite a large pick. In our day, of course, beating the Sem was very, very special. You always tried that bit harder against Killarney. I mean, is it still the same, the Sem being number one, or is there five or six colleges in Kerry now that share equal status?
We hadn't played the Sem until the final last week. Now we've played Tralee a couple of times, and they seem to be our team this year. We were drawn in the Corny Vree group and the Sullivan Cup group. So we've played those twice. We've beaten them once, they've beaten us once, so it's 1-1. And if we do manage to come over Flannans in the Corny Vree or overcome Flannans, we could be playing them in a semi-final. They're playing Rochester on a car.
Having said that, you're not going to look past Flannans?
Not at all, no. I was just trying to gather a bit of information. We wouldn't know a whole pile about them. They lost in the Harty Cup last Wednesday, so for them, this is all they're going to have left for the rest of the year. They're going to be one to watch, amongst others.
Okay. Well, they're always a tough breed.
Always going to be tough, yeah. You know, whenever we seem to be playing them, it's always a tough, hard game. Even the hurling game, I was laughing, the report in the paper. There was a guy sent off before the slitter was even thrown in, so...
We know what to expect.
We know what to expect.
Under no illusions.
Yeah.
You mentioned the young depth of talent you have at the moment with last year's County Division 1 under-16 final between Dingle and the Gaeta, being two memorable matches. A last-minute goal for Dingle, finally. Very similar to me, Dublin 91, some people commented. Now you have that. You're now kingpins of Kerry football, a large turnover from last year's team. Using as few cliches as you can possibly muster, are you finally going to bring the Corny Vree back to West Kerry?
I kind of dodged the question as well, but Liam, I won't use any cliches. All the teams at this level, honestly, it's going to be very, very tight this year. I think Crease Three winning last year has given the Cork teams added impetus. They all realise now that it's there to be won. It was won by the Kerry teams for 4 or 5 years in a row. Macroom are very strong, Rochestown are a developing team. But as you said, things look bright. We won the Under 15, the Mourne Cup final. We won the Sullivan Cup final. We're now in the Dunloe final, so it definitely seems to be our time, within Kerry anyway. whether that's going to transfer onto the Carnivore and the Munster stage, I suppose that remains to be seen.
John, I wish you the best of luck next Wednesday. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ian. Thank you very much. So where the love.
So where the love. Tomás Kavanagh, I play full forward. I play for Poboscot, Grina and Lisboa.
Hi, my name's Jack Sullivan. I play for Dingle, Poboscot, Grina and I play in the forwards.
I'm Gavin Corran. I play in goal for Dingle and the Poboscot.
I'm Paddy O'Shea. I play half-back for Poboscot and I also play at the rest. Where's the world? It's been a long, long time.
Congratulations on bringing the Sullivan Cup back to Askerry for the fourth time and for the historic first time for the Poboscot. Jack and Padraig, was it a surreal experience accepting the cup as joint captains a la Gooch and Declan Sullivan 06?
Yeah, kind of was. It was nice to bring it back for the first time in about 16, 17 years. So, yeah, it was a good experience really. But management couldn't separate us really.
Jack Fanry's decision really, yeah. We both go in our own way. Jack does a lot of athletics and I also play the best, so. So I decided really we wouldn't be at training all the time.
Gavin, your first job was picking the ball out of the net after 45 seconds of play. Were you feared the worst at that stage?
Thanks for that anyway, Liam. But learning on it really, like, you know, it's not the first time it's happened. I'm used to picking the ball out of the net, like, you know. But yeah, it was tough enough in fairness, like, because I don't think we've gone a game though this year, or maybe we've gone one game without conceding a goal. It's tough enough, like, you know, because we've good defence, like, but I don't know, just simple things, like, you know, simple mistakes.
There's no each other's game so well that can hardly play against each other at club level.
It does really, but we don't really play against each other at club level that often in the West Kerry Championship. But, helps too, like,
I suppose. There'd be no holding back at all.
Tom, Padraig and Gav, you were part of the Kerry Miners that went down to Tipperary narrowly last May. Did watching Tip win the All-Ireland afterwards, did it redeem you somewhat, or was it just rubbing salt into the wounds?
Rubbing salt into the wounds. Just 10 points, you know, and it slipped. And you see Tip winning an All-Ireland Minor final, and you know, that could have been us. So, yeah, it's rubbing salt into the wounds. I mean, you know, fair play to them, but it's still hard to take.
Should have been either.
Yeah.
Okay, are you looking past the fans next Wednesday?
Not really, no. I wouldn't put us as the kingpins really, because Green beat us there before Christmas, so, you know, we might be playing them for the semi-final. Hopefully now we'll get over Flannels, but you can't really look past them.
Yeah, underage, younger fellas have helped us get better ourselves. They're improving the standard of training and everything, so we're hoping to get past Flannels, but we're not putting anything past them.
Jack, yourself viewed a great victory in athletics recently. You won some cross-country race. Was it the college's cross-country?
Yeah, it was college's cross-country race.
Do you see your future more on track and field rather than getting football?
I do, yeah. Well, this is my last football competition I'll set for a few years. Hopefully the athletics might go better. But yeah, it'd be nice not to leave and I could not win in the current relay. Like, you know.
Of course it would.
Yeah.
I wish you the best of luck next Wednesday.
Thanks. Yeah. So where's the
love? Just cause you think it's trapped. So where's the love? You're the devil's mistress. So where's the love? Let truth be told. So where's the love?
On the bhí an aglaimh sin déanta, bhuaigh Fearn an Dangan an cluiche cathrú ceannais i gcoinne St Finian's. Beg an chéad cluiche eile a imirt acu i gCill Árna i gcoinne trálaí ar an dara lá déag de Feabhra agus tá súil againn go n-éireoidh go maith leo. Anois mar a dúirmear i tasach an seó, is áit iontach í an Dangan ó thaobh an cheol de ach ní amháin tuis ceoltóirí domhanda de. Tá roinntas na ceoltóirí is fear againn hénig an seo i gCorcaigh. sample a wine de show no contemporary folk band de Lucis Patent. Is as an dangen bald don Vanichol, Deirdre Granville, agus fi Eva and McCarthy's arish chun lauert le Deirdre fi cursi on banna.
My name is Eva Ní Húlbhonn. Now we're here in McCarthy's bar and music venue in Dingle. Now, at Telfeast Struggle, we've had bands of varying music genres, but none as unique as the band today, De Lucis Patent. Now, of course, they have a strong local connection with Adrian and Deirdre living here in Dingle Town, and Deirdre Granville, of course, is a native of Dingle Town, and we'll welcome her here to McCarthy's bar. So thanks for joining me, Deirdre.
Thank you very much.
Starting off with how the band formed, of course, yourself and Evelyn are natives of Kerry, but Adrian and Connor are from Cork, so tell us how you formed.
Well, as you said, the Kerry-Cork connection, we were all living in Cork for several years and got to know each other through this really strong music scene there and lots of sessions, and from playing together in sessions and going to the same kind of concerts and things, we just got to know each other that way. And myself and Evelyn did know each other from when we were young, from being in choirs and the likes through the Kerry School of Music. But then just playing together, and then Connor and Evelyn decided they wanted to do something like a singing band together. So then they approached me, and then Adrian and Connor had been playing together kind of more ballad sessions. So we just said we'd see what we could do with the four of us, and it went from there.
Very good. It's worked out very well anyway. A lot of controversy always about band names. In your name, De Lucis Patent is quite unusual. So tell us where the name came from.
It's a funny name, and it was hard to find. We were struggling trying to find a name for it. We had a gig coming up in January last year, and we had nothing, so we were practicing one day in the Corner House pub in Cork. It's a great music pub again, and after practice we just noticed this brass plate behind the bar which said De Lucis Patent on it, so we were just querying what that was, and after a little bit of research we found out that De Lucis was, I think, originally comes from Normandy, and it's translated to Old Lusig here in Ireland, but still looking up what exactly is, but or is there more to the name, but we'll go with it for the time being anyway.
Of course, your album is just out. Some of your songs are quite unusual. Some of the ones that stand out, Tom Payne's Bones and Unknown and I. Tell us about those songs.
I suppose we were doing a lot of practice together, and we kind of, Connor and Adrian, as I said already, they were doing a lot of playing together and gigs in Cork, and there was some that they had their own repertoire for us, and we just took those songs and kind of messed around and added the two extra voice or harp in.
I'm Nobody laughs and nobody cries. Where he's gone and how he fares, nobody knows and nobody cares. I'll dance to Tom Paine's bones. I'll dance to Tom Paine's bones. I'll dance to the oldest boots I own.
Your album is just out. Some of your songs are quite unusual. Some of the ones that stand out, Tom Paine's Bones and Oh No Not I. Tell us about those songs.
Well, in the case of Tom Paine's Bone, that was a song that Adrian and Connor used to sing quite a lot. So we just arranged it for the four, and we were quite comfortable singing it. It settles us into a lot of gigs, so we said it was an easy choice. And Oh No Not I, we wanted to just fit in the four vocals, or, you know, male and female vocal with Evelyn and Adrian, and then add the bit of instrumental at the end, so we thought it was a lively one to kind of start the album. We were very lucky then with other choices, that Connor is a great songwriter and also instrumental piece writer, so that was where Shoon the Lower came from, the instrumental and on the Road, one of his own songs. Then other choices, we wanted to have the traditional elements showing, so, you know, Evelyn is very well used to singing Galway to Graceland, so that was an obvious choice. And then we wanted to have a fitting tribute to Dingle, where we recorded the album. So Land of the Gael kind of describes all the elements of West Kerry and Corfoirin and that, so that was an easy choice for the end.
Very good. Well, you've got a good mixture on the album anyway. Your sound, I guess, would be described as contemporary folk. What kind of audience do you play to?
Well, we'll play for anyone, really, but I suppose a lot of people can think we're more traditional musicians. Yeah. I know a lot of my friends even were surprised when they first went to summer gigs, because they were expecting to have what they might describe as diddly eye, but yeah. We kind of want to have it more accessible to everyone, you know, that their songs, there is a strong influence of Irish music, but there's influence of other music, you know. I mean, the boys are very... very influenced by Bob Dylan, John Martin. So, I mean, we try to kind of look to all those things in our music. We also like, all of us love what's going on in Scotland as well, the music over there, and kind of try to be more experimental, maybe, you know. So, audience-wise, I suppose we're still trying to find our audience, we hope we can kind of cater to all tastes.
Your music, I guess, contemporary folk would be described as. Do you find you get a lot of airplay on Irish radio stations?
We've been very, very lucky. In Kerry, Radio Kerry, Danny Mahoney has been very good. He's played several times across the country, Clare FM, and I know I've heard that we've had some airplay in Shannon's side. But RT1 in particular has been very, very good. Ellen Cranitch on Grace Notes, and we were very lucky at the Cork Folk Festival this year that we had a live spot with Peter Brown on the Rolling Waves, so that was great. It was very enjoyable and just makes a huge difference to getting yourself known and getting out. Creole.
there about Tom Paine's Bones and some other songs. Tell us about your new material, London Burning Shadows, songs like that.
I suppose we just were used to, we did so much practice for, you know, preparing for the first album, we didn't want to just leave that, you know, work ethic kind of fall apart. So we're just trying to keep ourselves working hard all the time. With London's Burning Shadow, we're lucky that we have a lot of, in the circle we are, particularly in Cork, a lot of friends that are songwriters and such. London's Burning Shadow is by a great songwriter, Barry Tierney, young fella. He's only 22, but he's writing like someone who's been doing it for a lot longer than that. We were also, you know, we wanted to kind of do a lot of songs by maybe Cork singer songwriters. We were lucky as well, another friend of ours, Johnny Neville. We took on one of his songs for the album Cottonwood and Blue, but we want to maybe try out a few more of his as well, you know. So just, we're always just looking for new material. We'll try anything really and just see how it goes. You know, some things work in practices, some things don't.
It's very unusual to have a harpist in a band. When did you start playing the harp?
Well, if I admitted how long ago I started playing the harp, I'd like give away my age. So all I'll say is that Santa brought me my first harp, so it's a while ago.
Okay, well, I can't have you here without asking about the Dingle Tradfest as founding member. When you founded the Tradfest, what was your overall vision?
I suppose I really wanted to have a festival that was kind of more intuitive, or maybe a very youthful approach, just to have, you know, to cater towards audiences from a young age up to, you know, 60. But there's so many festivals in Dingle, you know, you have a festival nearly every weekend, but I didn't think there was a music festival. Phil and Delta is great, but just a music-only festival that, you know, you show sessions, concerts, you have all the elements of the music, and getting everyone involved, that was my main aim. But to, you know, some people, what they perceive as Irish music is very old-fashioned, and I know from going to festivals myself, it isn't, you know, there's so many young people playing, and it's very energetic and lively, mm-hmm. and I think we succeeded, I think, this year to kind of show that it's not just for older musicians, that anyone can get involved. So
very right. And for people now who want to, you know, find out more about Elusive Patent and their music, where is your music available?
Well, if you go onto the website, it's elusivepatent.com, or we have Facebook also. We put regular status updates there, but you can buy the album through both those sites. It's on iTunes, CD Baby, and tradtunes.com. And it's also in most shops nationwide, really, at this stage. There's the shop at Kilvin Bangin and in Maz's Dingle Record Shop and Tralee, Clarny, Dublin, and a few other places. So, no excuses.
Very good. lastly, before I leave you go, what's next for Delicious Patent?
I suppose we're just getting the album out there, gigging a lot. We found out today we're very lucky we're going to be playing at Celtic Connections Festival in Glasgow, so it's an international festival, so we're delighted about that. And then we're touring the album. We're off to Russia in March, and then Germany during the summer, and around the country a little bit in March and April. And other than that, then we might try and, you know, we're trying to prepare a bit more material for maybe looking at another album then towards the end of next summer. So.
Very good. Well, best of luck with that.
No foul and sailor when walking on the strand, spied a pretty pagan maiden, took her by the hand, saying, "Will you come?" Newfoundland away with me, he cried, but the answer that she gave was, "Oh, I." Pretty pagan maid began to grow shy. Of course, it would not meet, and her apron would not tie. Made her think of all that's made, she said, "Oh, child upon your back and the pain in the cold. When
when you get tired, you can sit down here and cry, and you think of all the times that she said no.
Here at Telling Peach Guggle. Again, as Deirdre said, their music is available on delucespatent.com, which is their website, and their Facebook page, Delucis Patent, so be sure to check that out. We're very lucky here in Dingle in that we get them to play regularly here. So that's it for me. Long before.
Mas maith éan olas breise faoin banna úntach sin téir chuig delucespatent.com. Well, sin deire an chéad seo de 2022 agus tá súlagan go mbun sibh tainmhas. Má tá aon rud eile a heastaíonn mo feiscint ar an seo, sheolfar go tuairmí chuig scrugaltv@gmail.com. Chomá leis an seo míosúil, beidh e-mail an phobal thar naisruibh uair sa gaigh ís. Gnáirigh go geal leis an pobal scoil sa chéad chluiche eile agus cíhimid sibh ag deire an mí sa chuin. Sláinte go fóill.